Dan the duct tape ball says, not a political question, but Steven.
I like that.
Dave.
So Stephen, I know you did some acting early in your career, one being the movie To Save a Life. I find this funny because I remember watching that movie back in 2011.
That movie was a steaming dog turd.
I was embarrassed.
My question is, how did working on that movie affect who you are? Did it make you love acting, hate it? Did working on the movie affect your faith at all, or how you think about people?
Okay. Oh, that movie was so bad I stopped believing in God.
I watched it and rejected Christ.
I was trying to end the life.
Compared to a lot of the Christian films that had been out at that point, it was significantly better. They had actual actors. Yeah. But they tried to fit, I think, too many lessons in one film.
Yeah.
Also, and then I mentioned Dave's point of view, because I started out acting first. You know, I started out when I was 12 and doing commercials and television and film. And I will say this, and I started doing stand-up because, I always wanted to do stand-up, but the unions killed the industry in Montreal.
Yeah.
And then stand-up took me full circle into pilots and some films there in the United States. And I just got to a point where I realized that I didn't play well with others, particularly when the others were just far-left hacks who they demanded groupthink. When I got invited to an Obama fundraiser, and it wasn't that I was invited to an Obama fundraiser, it was that everyone assumed that I was going to go to an Obama fundraiser.
And actually, give.
Yeah. I just said, at a certain point, right, I'm not going to be silent about who I am. Right. I either just have to, because all these people will say, be who you are, keep it real. And then they go, you want to go to an Obama fundraiser? God forbid if you just said, no, actually, I don't really like McCain, but I like anyone who's not Barack Obama at this point. You would be rejected. And I lost managers and I lost agents. And that's when I told my parents, I said, look, I just need you to trust me here, because I was living in LA. And I said, I'm going to come back home and live at home for 6 months. Just so that I can do this full time YouTube thing where I just was messaging people all day. And I was still doing stand up on the road, I would say probably about 2 weekends a month. Then it developed into what you see here. But I realized at a certain point that I couldn't actually be me and work in that industry. It wasn't a needle I could thread.
Well, it was good. It was good that you turned down that feature on Epstein Island as well.
Yes.
You never wanted to be.
Well, it was a limited release. It was Epstein's basement.
He watched Canadian Harvey Weinstein pleasure himself into a plant.
Right. Yeah, and it was just a guy with a horrible maritime accent in it, and the plant was a conch. What was your experience like? Because we talked about this in stand-up. It's a lot of people like to act as though there's a brotherhood. There's really not.
You guys fought. Like, actors and comedians were, like, at odds.
No, I mean, stand-up comedians, they all act like, community, and it's a brotherhood. Gotcha. And then I remember when I got into the Just for Laughs Festival, people were all saying, oh, he's not any good, whereas they before were saying, oh, you're really funny, I hope you get in the Just for Laughs. And then they think you take the spot.
Well, especially now with podcasting, I mean, even me getting this show, you know, it's like, the problem is there is a brotherhood to a sense with your own friends. Like, my friend Matt McClowery, who tours around with me, is amazing. Like, we're really good friends. Like, there are certain people you do meet, but it's based on their character that you will stay friends for a very, very long time. But yeah, most of the industry's people that are going to stab you in the back. They're constantly trying to, like, speak over you, whatever you're on, get over you, use you. And then once they're a little bit past you, they don't really throw the rope back. And it's like, for me, anytime I've opened a door, I've tried to open it for somebody else.
Right.
And that's very rare in this business. And I'm not saying I'm amazing, even though I am. Right. It's just that I do really try to help other people. And that's not heard of very much at all.
Right. And it's even worse than that, where you have some people who pull the rope up, like shock comics like Amy Schumer or Sarah Silverman.
Right.
Who, you know, got by on the backs of jokes that they were just offensive, right? The bait and switch. And I'm not saying that they, Sarah Silverman was funny at a time, and then says, now you can't say words. Like, when you go from her making jokes about Ethiopia, about African famine victims, now going, when you say that's gay, do you know what you say? Do you know who you hurt? It's like, so all you're doing now is saying that other people can't use the tools that you used to get to the top.
Well, it's like Jimmy Kimmel, who was a shock jock, and if you even remember when he first got his show, it was Snoop Dogg was his co-host, and everybody was drunk, so they had to ban alcohol in the studio. Like, there's a guy...
But not weed!
There's a guy who, you know, was essentially Crank Yankers. Everything was offensive.
The introduction to his show was women jumping on a trampoline.
Yeah. Right. And same with Carolla, but Carolla stuck with that.
Yeah.
And, you know, Kimmel didn't. But I also wonder how many of these people are just doing this to stay in the Hollywood system.
Yeah.
And the problem with that is the more people that do that, the less it creates authenticity.
Watch Louder with Crowder live, Monday through Thursday, 10 a.m. Eastern.